a conversation with the authors of the Naglieri General Ability Tests by MHS. The Naglieri General Ability Tests measure what a student thinks rather than what they know. What does that mean exactly?
So traditionally, intelligence tests that have been used include knowledge. It's typical for an intelligence test to have a vocabulary subtest or a word analogy subtest. And of course, that demands knowledge as well as thinking. This creates a real problem for children who don't have opportunity to learn, or children who are learning English. And they come to school and they could be really, really smart. When they take that kind of a test, they're not going to show up as being smart enough because they haven't had the opportunity to learn. So this concept of measuring intelligence in a way that evaluates how well a child can solve a problem by thinking, and that test question doesn't require knowledge, that's the essence of what we did across these three domains of verbal, quantitative, and nonverbal. And those three descriptions are description of the test questions, not some kind of thinking. But in every case, the student needs to be able to think about the relationships of pictures that represent a verbal concept, or numbers to see patterns in the numbers, or shapes to see patterns in the shapes.
What we're saying, because like Jack said, it's the construct of the test item that makes it verbal, quantitative, or nonverbal. They're all avenues to measure general ability. So that's where we wanted to have all three, because we know that some kids are going to have strengths in some areas and not as much in other areas, but they're all, the ultimate goal is to identify students who have high potential. They're smart. They might not be highly achieving yet. These are not tests to identify students for advanced academic programs where they need to be accelerated. It's to measure who has that potential.
Tell us more about what the Naglieri General Ability Tests are comprised of. Please describe the verbal test.
When Jack asked me to work on the verbal test with him, we started thinking about if all the students spoke a different language, we would definitely need to take the words out of the test. So we're looking at conceptual understanding and how students can arrive at a solution based on these pictures that are presented and find relationships between those pictures.
When I read Luria's book, Language and Cognition, he talked about a technique called a superfluous fourth. And what that meant was Luria would say four words, and one of the words wouldn't go with the other three. And I like that idea. I'd actually been thinking about it for a long time. And so what we really have created is a verbal test where each item describes something, some attribute. It could be as simple as every one of these has the color blue in it and this one doesn't, although we don't do that kind of an item, but that conceptually could be.
Tell us more about the nonverbal test.
So I've been writing items that are described as nonverbal measures of ability since the late 70s. And every time I create another edition, I always try to make it better than the previous one. So I created new ways to actually make matrices items. And we don't talk about it because we don't want people to try to prep kids by knowing different styles of the matrices and things like that. But they work. They're very powerful, just like the verbal and the quant. They're very powerful. They measure general ability in a way that's accessible to everyone.
Tell us more about the quantitative test.
It's not about math. It's not about addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. It's not about that. It's about reasoning in quantitative reasoning.
Oftentimes people ask us, what do you mean it doesn't measure academic knowledge? In the quantitative test, we wouldn't have a question that would be more easily answered because the student recognized a question that would demand knowing what Pascal's triangle is or any of those kind of mathematics. Facts, because that would be introducing knowledge into the equation of solving the problem. And the same thing is true with the verbal side. If you think about a traditional vocabulary test on a standard intelligence test, it starts off with high frequency words and then it goes down to low frequency words. And the kind of words that the student doesn't hear very often makes it more difficult. We don't do that. It's clearly, when you look at all the items, it's not about academic knowledge. It's about looking at relationships, whether it's numbers, pictures that represent verbal concepts, or just shapes, and figuring out what's the pattern. How do they go together, and why this one's not right, this one isn't, this one, but this is the right one.
There's so much research that shows test anxiety in kids. The thousands of kids that I've tested in the past, you clearly can see, especially if they know they're coming in to be tested for a gifted program. And so this is just so user-friendly. It's just so easy for them to come in. It doesn't feel like a test. It feels like it feels more like a game that they're doing. And so we have reduced that level of test anxiety for every single kid that's taking this assessment.
Can you give an example of how cultural influence was carefully considered when creating test items?
Pertaining to the verbal test, what MHS did is they consulted with experts from different cultures. So we wanted to make sure that we removed as much cultural influence out of the test items, especially the verbal ones because they're pictures. And so we want to make sure there wasn't offensive or uncertainty to any specific group. And so, for example, you won't see pictures with cows or pigs or even dogs. We wanted to make sure that they could be answered regardless of the culture or the language that the child spoke. So there are those safeguards built in.
For more information, visit storefront.mhs.com/collections/Naglieri-ability-tests or scan the QR code.